chest, yeah. Sitting close, all alone. Try to hold your hand, but a second kiss. Say you wanna take it slow, if you wanna slow it down. I just need to know if you're gonna be mine. I could take it slow. Such a rush between us. You make me such a nervous, reckless mess. I can see us in the future. I know I've got to hold back. Say you wanna take it slow.
Take it slow, but I wasn't really taught how to show love. Cause feelings for the weak, right? But I can pull them panties down and clap them cheeks under the sheets, right? Nah, cause that's the me that my ex knew. Trying to be a bitter man to get next to you. No complaints about the view, though. You that Mrs. Plump up in the kitchen talking Cluedo. I ain't got a clue, though. How to be your own, I'm playing games. Yeah, I cheated, but the Hasbro give me kudos. Honestly, my heart is beating out my chest. See, I never found love, but I think you the address.
Yeah. Take it slow.
This is Digital Leaders Boardroom. In 4 episodes, we will discuss with digital leaders how to develop a digital-first strategy. Let's dive in. Hello, this is Digital Leaders Boardroom, and it is a special series in terms of how to create your digital first strategy. And we will cover a serious number of topics, such as, digital edge, digital ecosystems, sustainability, and of course, the theme of today. And this is the first topic to address in this series, and that is, it's about economy. It's about really a subscription economy, so to speak. I have some serious digital leaders at my table, and let me introduce them in short, as always. So we got Judith from Equinix. I got Mel, and she's from ABN AMRO. But she's not only from ABN AMRO, she's also CEO of the year 21. I got Nick, and Nick is from BCG, from Boston Consulting Group. And I got Martin, and Martin is from HPE. So welcome, everybody. And I'm looking forward to having a serious discussion on subscription economy, so to speak, right? So the change is what we will see in. But before we start, let me ask Nick to give us a little bit setting the scene here, right? So where are we in this in the context of this theme?
Yeah, first of all, it's a super cool topic and very cool to be on the boardroom with these digital leaders. Before diving into what we see happening in the market, I've thought of bringing one page where we can really have a bit of a framework to have our discussion around on what is actually that subscription economy. And if we in BC look at this market, we look actually at the sharing economy, which is a little bit broader than solely subscription. It consists out of subscription, but also peer-to-peer, and also circularity or secondhand. And the combination of those three topics we call the sharing economy. And we have certain examples presented here on the page, but I think we will do also more realistic Dutch examples during our discussion. So maybe I'll go to the next page to explain a bit what we see happening from a purely market dynamics in the subscription economy. Actually, we see multiple sub-areas where the market is developing upon. Think of mobility, but also peer-to-peer lending. There's also something called accommodation. I think all of us have once booked an Airbnb at the time. And we see that the market is really, really growing. We had a small dip during COVID when we saw the market decreasing a bit, but our outlooks for 2025 is that we foresee a CAGR of over 20%. So it's definitely a booming and a growing market. To close off this discussion before to really dive into the examples, there's one cool example I wanted to show. Also because I recently bought a car, and when I was having a discussion with the dealer, he said, Nick, this might be the last car that you will be buying. And then we were actually brainstorming a bit on what will this mean for the entire value chain. Because in the past, you would have a car that was being produced, then brought to a dealer, and then sold. So the whole go-to-market strategy was ended from production towards a one-off sale. Now, when you would like, for example, to go to Link & Co, which is one of those cars that we now see driving around for 500 euros a week, or sorry, a month, you can drive that particular car. They have to think of, as of day one, on how do you now build that network? How do you now build up your install base in order to actually have sufficient cars to fulfill that? So as of the moment of production, you need to think on completely different elements to really be part of that sharing economy.
Well, that's some interesting thoughts, and we will take that, of course, along in this fine discussion. So let me start in terms of what we always call peeling the onion, so to speak. So let's talk about the market dynamics today, and then go into the benefits of a subscription economy, and then what is needed. And of course, to top off is leadership. How are we going to make that work, so to speak? So to address that first question, so your strategic challenges within ABN AMRO in this context, Mel?
In the context of a subscription model economy?
For example, right.
Well, I think the subscription economy is disintermediating the whole value chain. And if you look on how you finance a value chain, you have to understand how that value chain will be disintermediated. And then you change the way you interact with your clients in that value chain. So from a business perspective, it's really rethinking how we interact with our commercial clients, so the big corporates. That is where it's interesting. On the other hand, if you look at our retail customers, you see they are much and much more using subscriptions. And so they have a subscription to Netflix, to Swapbike, to a shaving company, all these kind of things. They have to understand that this is a monthly cost, and it must be easy to stop and start these subscriptions. So we, for instance, offer in Grip, one of our insights into financial situations, an easy stopping subscription economy service that you can switch things on and off. So on both sides, we help our clients in changing their model, their buying model to subscription, right, and their own value chain.
Right. And if you look to then, Nick, what does it mean from a technology point of view? So what major changes does that implicable?
Yeah, I think the main topic that we see happening is scalability that you really need to have in place. Because if you want to have a subscription model, for example, Mail or Europe, or would like to have something shortly or moderately different than one of your peers. So, for example, the way how you think of the modularity in your IT architecture to, for example, combine an insurance with a banking package, or the ability, for example, if I do an insurance on my rental car or on my Uber, thinking of how you can smartly combine those particular products requires your IT to be much more modular and flexible in order to build those subscription packages.
Right. Is that a dilemma for you in conjunction with the fact that at the one side you need to have a trustworthy systems, you need to have regulations, you need to have X, and then a guy comes along and said, hey, Mel, subscription models, here we go.
Yeah, of course it is. Yeah. First of all, I think we are transforming the way we do IT. Yeah? So I think the topic here is a digital boardroom, so a digital transformation. On the one hand, we are building the infrastructure for the future, a data roadmap and an IT transformation roadmap, but that's only the infrastructure under our bank. The business models and the business thinking is what will get value out of these transformations. But many of our products now are monolithical, built into applications, coded from origination to operations in the same application. That is where we need to do the rethinking and modularization and transforming it into those new highways. And then we can really interact on all levels with our clients. So we are building and we call it a Z model. Right. Where we sometimes partner, we sometimes ecosystem, and we sometimes give the product ourselves. And it's no longer about bringing the customer to us and to our channels, but to being there where the customer is in their channels. And that is on both sides, from the application to the infrastructure to the data model. That's where we have to change everything.
Right.
But the most important part, by the way, is the rethinking of the business in their business models. We only lay the infrastructure and show them the capabilities.
Right. And that is a serious daily business anyhow, right?
Yeah.
So if I bring that question to you, Martin, if you look to these developments, in the conversations you have as HPE with your customers, likewise discussions, different developments, what can you share with us on that?
Yeah, so the first thing is what Mel said, that's really true. So it's about the value the customer receives. So he is not looking for infrastructure or for the ABN AMRO, he's looking for a certain outcome. So he has a problem or he would like to develop something and then he would like to have it on demand. And what you said is also true, then it should be at least stick to the governance or the rules he has as a company. So sometimes data should be in the Netherlands, sometimes it can be anywhere, etc. So you should deliver as a company, we as HPE, that experience. And then it should flow like you bought your car. So it should flow in a way he is used to. Yeah, to get Netflix or Airbnb, that doesn't matter. But he is used now to a different model than just buying something and then keeping it for 4 years and then selling it back. So we have exactly the same. So what we do is that we change our, let's say, infrastructure, not upwards in newer or whatever, better, but more into the experience. You can buy it, but you can also consume it. You can put it on and off, like Mel said. That's the way it should work.
Right. So, and if you then look to the insights from Equinix here, Judith, what do you think in regards to the subscription models is important, and what can you add in terms of value then?
So to, I guess to Mel's point, just to go back to the foundational infrastructure needs to be both physical and virtual. And on the virtual side, we've become a subscription model company as well. So we're offering digital services which allow companies to scale up, scale down, go into new markets, turn it on, turn it off. So it's essentially the same thing that's supporting all of it. We're evolving with our customers and realizing that as their strategies change far more quickly than before, they're needing to be more agile, they need the security, they need speed, they need all these partners to be in the same place to connect, disconnect, whatever they want to do in terms of their strategy, which is far more dynamic than before.
And how do you handle that? And if I hear Mel's just a second ago saying we got that Z, right? Modeling in how you evolve ecosystems, how you or not, or do it yourself, etc. I can imagine that from an ecosystem perspective with your business partners, you got the same dilemmas sometimes, right? Of how do you coordinate, how do you get that grip in terms of that ecosystem with your partners, but ecosystem also with your customers there.
Right, so essentially in all our metros across the world, the ecosystems have a lot of similarities. So you're basically offering the cloud to multi-cloud strategies and support those. We have all these network service providers that also come in associated with the cloud, but associated with customers. And then the customers themselves will often say to their partners and to their suppliers, we need you to be in the same data center as us, or we need you to be in the same ecosystem as us to be able to get that low latency, high performance on applications, on security, et cetera, et cetera.
Right.
So I guess over, you know, we have 10,000 plus customers and they bring their own ecosystems to be able to, you know, adopt their digital strategies as they need to.
Right. So how many discussions do you will see happening in the near future about let's say, the maturity levels of ecosystems. And if you look how, for example, Mel just described our various principles in collaboration and ecosystems themselves in their journeys to the digital transformation.
Yep.
What is the main point here?
So for me, the main point is that we are shifting from an ownership society towards a usage or a collaboration society. And by doing that, you automatically place the concept of two-sided markets actually on this new economy, when there is also, when there is an actor and a user, let's say, of that particular service. And because of that two-sidedness in the market, the key unlock will be how do you gain scale and volume very, very fast. So if we have analyzed certain companies that came into existence over the last 5 years, you see the time to 1 million customers became much shorter. So I don't know if everybody remembers still Clubhouse from the beginning of the year.
Very shortly. Yeah.
Very shortly, but they were, I think, the record holder into, I think, 10 million customers on their subscription model, and also dropped, by the way, indeed, very soon thereafter. But the trick of how to gain your network very, very fast will be key in order for these markets to develop.
Right, right. All right, so before we go into the benefits of that subscription model, let's look first in an ABN AMRO today.
Succes. Wat betekent succes? Betekent het veel geld verdienen? Echt bergen geld verdienen? Rijk worden ten koste van kinderen die moeten werken in de mijnen of goedkope kleding moeten produceren in fabrieken? Als je heel eerlijk bent, wat maakt het eigenlijk uit als we veel geld verdienen maar er niets goeds mee doen? Banken moeten hun steentje bijdragen aan een betere wereld voor toekomstige generaties. Ze hebben de mogelijkheden om nieuwe ideeën te financieren, de energietransitie te ondersteunen en banen te creëren. Banken moeten hun verantwoordelijkheid nemen. Ze moeten bovendien met de tijd meegaan, luisteren naar mensen van alle leeftijden en zich echt voor iedereen inzetten. We hebben allemaal een verantwoordelijkheid ten opzichte van elkaar en ten opzichte van de planeet. Het is 11:55. We moeten nadenken over de toekomst, investeren, bouwen en andere manieren vinden om welvaart te creëren. Ik weet zeker dat we succesvol kunnen zijn zonder onze maatschappij schade toe te brengen. Dat kan, met goede ideeën. We zien pas echt een verschil als er meer projecten komen om de oceanen op te ruimen. Als we meer energie-neutrale huizen bouwen en als we iedereen gelijke kansen geven. Het moet onze prioriteit zijn om steun te bieden aan iedereen die de wereld beter wil maken. Wat als banken anders zouden gaan nadenken, als ze nieuwe ideeën zouden stimuleren? Als ze zich zouden inzetten voor een meer rechtvaardige toekomst door de juiste bedrijven te steunen? Uiteindelijk is het zo moeilijk niet. We moeten gewoon de juiste prioriteiten stellen. Toch?
Yep, I think that gives a fine glimpse of the future, but also on the developments of the future. So in this case, Mel, you see that there's increasingly working on the subscription model. So why is that? Is that from a tech push or from a business pull?
It's from a business pull, I would say. But we just saw the movie also on sustainability. I think also circularity is very important in the subscription model, to really think how we work and use our resources. And I hope that is also a main driver for the models that we are introducing, is that it goes back to the producer and they take care of the materials, they reuse them, they bring them into the value chain. So it's a business pull, but I also think it's a sustainability pull there, and it's tech enabling both.
Right. And if you look to those models today, Nick, what problems could they solve, or what could they benefit?
Yeah. So if I can share one of the slides that
right,
I brought.
Of course.
I think
that's BCG, right?
Exactly. The slides. We need
the guy of the slides. So I think there are three main factors really driving this economy. And there are technology factors, like you mentioned, Rob. There are definitely business or economical factors and demographic factors. So that we've tried to outline on the left-hand side of this page to see why do we see now happening, why do we now see this uptake in the sharing economy happen. I think the point that Mel rightfully made is on the top, which we mentioned as excess of everything. Yeah. So imagine you going now to Schiphol and seeing there's immense car park of cars that have don't do anything.
Yeah.
If we just reflect on that, it is a little bit crazy that there are so much unused solutions on the planet that are not being utilized. So I think that's really a demographic factor, and the new generation is really sensitive to it. So that's, I think, the demographic element that we foresee. Then going to the economic or business elements of it, we see an over capacity of cash currently in the market. So there are a lot of VC funds really investing in those type of models because of those demographic factors and also the use that it can bring. And thirdly, it's enabled by technology. So the order that Mel mentioned, we also see that happening. Business-led, enabled by technology. But because we have now modular technology in place, we have now the ability to do peer-to-peer transactions at high speed. And maybe Equinix can also point in on that a little bit. We are also much better able to deliver those type of services that maybe were not possible 5 or 10 years ago. So that's really the sharing economy drivers that we foresee. Then if you look to the right-hand side of the page, how do you then foster that adoption? I think that's the network effects that we talked about earlier. So how do you incentivize both sides of the market to make their cars available when they're not doing anything? And on the other side, make it easy for users to actually take part in that sharing economy.
All right, then it pops up for me the question, what challenges does it bring to everyone who is stepping in those new delivery models, right?
Yeah, and it depends, I think, a little bit if you are a new company and you're born like as a service and subscription, because then you have A, no legacy, B, no customers, and C, there's nothing to lose. But then it's different. So as a startup, you try something, and if you fail, you start something else. So try, fail fast, and start again. Right. We as companies which do have already an install base of customers where we deliver services, we need to keep for sure that they can consume the services they already expect from us today. So we as a company do have, let's say, the Z model, but we need to change. And we need to deliver still in the old way also our customers, because they need to change as well. By the way, a little bit back to the sustainability, that's a key part in a subscription model, because if you consume, you as a consumer are not the owner of what you consume. For example, the car, or within HP, the infrastructure, you are not the owner. And for us, it's way more easier to do anything with the equipment which is not used when you stop your subscription, get it reused, or make something out of it, or rebuild anything of it, because the skill of us is way higher than one consumer by itself. So sustainability is, for us, it's the way subscription is built, actually. Because, what I said, you own the equipment as we as HP, we own our own equipment, and then it's easier to make something out of it afterwards.
So now the question would then be fair, Judith. Mm-hmm. So how do you help your customers then to leapfrog? And what I mean with that is in these kind of new models versus we've got used to centralized infra. Now we see some developments in decentralized, right? Also from data point of view. Yep. Suddenly these kind of new models come. So how do you support it?
Yeah, so I suppose there's to Martin's point, there's the two groups. There's the well-established companies which are going through their digital transformation, and then there's those being born in the cloud, essentially. I think there's far more flexibility for those in the cloud because they don't have the legacy, to Martin's point. But for those that need to move from a central to flexible to cloud, we have everything there for them. A great example is we have another banking customer headquartered in Southern Europe, 80 million customers. They launched their app and they got about 2.3 million new customers. And they essentially came to us and said, look, we want to invest new markets. We want to give back wealth to our shareholders, but we still want to consider sustainability as our key priority. And we helped them launch into 30 new markets just through virtual infrastructure. So they have no actual physical infrastructure in any of those new markets, yet they're able to launch their whole new market in there and acquire new customers. So there's a whole new dynamic around just how we interconnect through the cloud. And we have this service called Equinix Fabric, which essentially is the layer that connects all our data centers. And then on top of that, we layer our digital services, which again are all virtual infrastructure supported.
Right. If you look to this, Mel, and from out that topic of subscription models, what does it mean in a discussion where we see that value models, right, and value journeys are much more important, and suddenly at the other side, there's modular IT? So it's a big shift in what we first built, and now saying, okay, let's break that down. Modular IT there, quick and dirty, and here are the value streams. And suddenly, this is a different game.
Yes, I'm not completely getting what you're going after, but what I think is very important in subscription models is the customer experience. So that's where the true value lies. So why do people want ownership? They like the ease of the car sitting right in front of their doorstep and at their use at every moment. They like the status of ownership. So these are drivers for ownership. That has to be fulfilled in customer experience. So the status of a cool app or a great customer experience or showing that you are part of a sustainable person, that status part is important, but the ease of use, the customer value, the customer experience is key. And that's what drives what people from ownership to subscription. And then, of course, enabled by the technology, the modularity, being able to be there, being able to adapt quickly to an ever-changing customer need, that's extremely important. Because right. What's cool today is passé tomorrow. So that you have to keep up with that speed.
Right. In this sense, what I try to embrace is in the discussion that is, we are talking away about the value journeys today. We hear about customer experience, but you've not seen them always convey in those new models, right?
Yeah.
And then it's easy to say we go for the value journeys and we need to do model RT because, right?
Yeah.
And then suddenly you are.
Oh yeah, but that's why business and IT have to be so close on these
right.
topics, and that extremely important because and I still see that divide too much. Yeah? So it's business thinking about requirements and IT building data and infrastructure roadmaps. That also that has to be not disintermediated, but combined. It's business talking about what problems do they have? How can we solve them together with IT as one team, also with the risk parties involved and the compliance parties, and then show how we solve problems through technology and by understanding the customer need. And no longer business here and IT there. It's in the same team, together with the risk people, solving problems of customers.
Right.
Yeah.
So what are the pitfalls today for the CEOs, CDOs, CTOs here? Nick?
I think Mel rightfully brought one topic already to the table, right? So how can you really collaborate as business and IT into one team with shared objectives, shared KPIs? Not that IT is being looked at as a cost center that needs to be X percent of the revenue, but really being able to participate in that value delivery. I think that's a CEO topic because that would need to be brought together and sometimes being helped a little bit to be brought together through CEO involvement. I think that's definitely one of the topics. I think the second topic is, I think you mentioned it as well, some companies are born in the digital age, which is a different journey than companies that are born 50 or even longer ago that have to really work with legacy infrastructure and IT that needs to work. So that's the CIO/CDO challenge. How can I make sure that I can still deliver or compete with companies that actually are born in those digital ages, which is much more difficult because you still have to work with all of your legacy that you have. So they will be really my top two challenges for the CEOs. Yeah.
Right. And what does it mean for technology part such as Equinix?
So I think just to go back to Mel's point for a sec, I think it's a really exciting time for CIOs because they're getting a far more business savvy seat at the table rather than, to your point, business over here, you go and figure it out over here. So I think what it means for partners is we're pulling in the business and the technology piece to sit at the same table and tell us what their requirements are, and then work with partners like HPE to be able to provide the whole service and not just the piece that Equinix provides. There's a lot more to that. There's managed services. There's all the other service offerings that you guys offer as well. And essentially, we need to have all of these partners inside our data centers to be able to connect for speed, security, agility, and yeah, satisfy whatever requirements that CEO is needing to have. So whenever we ask our sales guys to go into accounts, we're saying, you know, you need to connect with both the CEOs and the CIOs to make sure we're getting the full picture of what's required.
And do we see enough maturity in the developments of, let's say, the offerings from of the supply side? So traditionally, we have seen CAPEX, and we go CAPEX OPEX. We go into licensing, then we go subscription models, and we go to SaaS and PaaS, etc. So what's the next generation here in terms of those kind of offerings, right? Because suddenly you need to be flexible in on and off of those new models, etc. Right?
Yeah.
So maybe if I can add something. So two things are really important, which I mentioned. The first thing is the status of being the owner. So you should remove that hat. Also internally, if you discuss with business and IT, doesn't matter who owns what. And secondly, if you work in an ecosystem, it means that sometimes it's not even visible towards the user that you, as a company, HP, are part of the overall solution. Mm-hmm. So for Mel, for example, if she needs to create something for the business, then it doesn't matter for her that we are somewhere in the solution, or if Equinix is in the solution. That doesn't matter. It is about the outcome. So I think the most important thing for us all together as IT companies, or as an IT internal vendor, actually, yeah, you should deliver services to your internal stakeholders. It's important that for us, the status doesn't really matter anymore. It doesn't matter if somebody recognizes that you are in the solution. You are together the solution.
Can I add something that I think that is also really important and that we're not actually addressing is digital trust. Because mm-hmm. the problem with losing ownership is that you have to trust many parties yep. on where the data is, what is happening to the data, on security, on being able to stop, scale up. And that is extremely important if we also go back to the consumer, because there's one thing clear, they are owner of their data. And with all this disintermediation, that is one of the things we need to tackle. Also the models we use, the AI we use, all these things is extremely important.
Make that too hazardous to enlarge, to incorporate these kind of subscription models also for the bank to your customers?
Yeah, I think that makes it that we don't go that fast as we want often. So we have seen some big legislative elements coming in that make us slow down. But it was a good slowdown because you get one chance to do it right, and that's when you start. And so yes, that is a complex part, but an extremely important part.
Right.
And our customers altogether are already familiar with the fact that we deliver the service, we know where the data is, we know how security is based. So what I said before is, when you are starting a new company, there's no customer who says to you, hey, this is wrong, or hey, where's my data? Because there is nobody. We have a lot of internal and external consumers, so we should be sure if we do something.
Mm-hmm. So if you see now also those kind of trends as subscription-based platforms to enable that, so what's going on here?
So maybe one point on what Mel is saying, because it's, I think, very important that if we analyze these markets, how do we look at those? And for us, the number one area that we focus upon is trust, mm-hmm. because that is something that it needs to work, it needs to be there. If we take the car example again, I'd love to have my car because it's available when I need it, and when it breaks down, I also know who to call in order to fix it. So that trust part, and that's especially in physical, but also in digital products, if it's about your own wealth, your own insurance, it's very important to have that. So that's our number one area that we look at. Then we follow a little bit of a traditional model, which is being often used in e-commerce, to see how a market is performing, which we call reach, conversion, cost. And they're important in that particular order. So trust, absolutely number one. Then we analyze a market for reach. How well are you able, from both sides of the market, to be able to participate in it? Are there sufficient cars? Is there sufficient Netflix available? Mm-hmm. Then convenience, so the whole user experience that you mentioned, Mel, very important, because that will determine if I'm actually going to make use of that service, or is it a complete hassle to get into a new subscription, then borrow or rent a particular house, and then actually turn it off again. The turning off again, very, very important in the subscription world. And then three is cost. So what is the additional cost that I need to make? But the order, very interesting to see, is trust, reach, conversion, cost.
And if trust is number one, and you look to your traditional partnerships, So how close can you then be with, for example, these kind of subscription model partnerships, right? If trust is number one.
Very close. Yeah, I mean, there. But that's because you. It's not only about signing the contract. It's about knowing who is behind the contract to also see if you have a fit on culture, teaming, transparency. Extremely important. Opening up the closet, showing what's inside, and then moving forward. So you can get very close, but you have to have more than a contract to get that close. You have to have a true partnership.
Right.
And also cater for when it goes wrong. So in the most trusted relationships, you understand that there's also a moment when the honeymoon is over, and you have to also cater for that moment.
Right.
Not be naive.
So in this case, what is then the value of modular IT and infrastructure?
Yeah. So if I can bring up one page again. So what we have seen is what are now the elements that we need in order to scale those digital solutions. We talked about the C-level engagement, both on the CEO ownership, but also business and IT partnerships. Then we've talked about how can we make modular, that's the number two in this area, capabilities. And then number three is how to realize that. What we have seen for companies that do this well, there is a 17% cost reduction available. So if you would like to launch a new service and you've worked through those modular IT, then you can do it at 17% lower cost. And there's a 17% revenue uplift, which I think is even more interesting, because that tells you that there is also an ability to be much better capable to fulfill those business requirements or business needs, because you can much easier click on and click off certain type of services. So I think we are all quite aware of the cost component that it could bring, or the cost reduction it could bring, but we also see a 17 to 20% revenue increase that it can deliver.
Right. So what change in infrastructure demand then do you foresee, Judith?
So I see, I think it's a great opportunity, again, for the established companies to do a whole refresh of their whole technology. They have legacy, which they need to keep them from just legacy systems. There's a serious interconnection need between the legacy systems, what they want to put in a data center, what they want to be able to connect with their partners, with their customers, with their whole ecosystem. So I think there's, again, back to the trust piece, there's a huge push for trust, security, agility, speed. They're the same components every time that we're being requested. And I think that's where, I suppose, from a where we sit on the digital infrastructure provider, that's where we're comfortable that we can provide all of that. Because as these companies are evolving, the ecosystems around them are evolving. And we're learning how we need to adapt our services to be able to scale up further, to be able to support this subscription model.
Right. You agree on this, Martin, or add something to that?
For sure, I agree. No, and the next step, what I said, we find every day in the ecosystem new collaborations, so new partners, because we work, for example, with Equinix. Normally, a customer consumed energy, rack space, etc. They buy some infrastructure, and then the ABN is going to build something. And then you thought, okay, we should deliver it as a service, and then you come together as a partner. But in the consumption, ABN, for example, experienced also that, hey, we can add something else on top of that, or hey, actually, we would like to have this and that, and then the ecosystem is changing. So I agree on it, and on the other hand, also, you should, as a company, as a vendor, also be flexible with who you work, and indeed, transparency, contracts, legal, etc. You need to deliver it in a way that your consumer can be sure that there is a level of trust and insurance what you deliver. Because in the end, if the data is on the street, they are going to call us all together. Hey, what did you do? So,
right. I would say let's go to a Moody.
It wasn't long ago that catching a ride like this, or accessing every single song in the world like this, or even connecting to your home like this.
Hello.
Seemed unimaginable, kind of like having the cloud experience outside the public cloud. But that experience is here, across all your apps and data, wherever they live, as a service.
We were the first to say the world will be hybrid, and it is.
Just as streaming brought the theater to you, and online shopping brought the entire store to you, HPE is bringing the entire cloud experience to you.
Cloud is not a destination, it is an experience.
Apps and data unified. Clouds, edges, data centers unified. This is more agility, instant insights, faster innovation, data gravity defied. All in one place, one single line of sight. One consistent experience. One direct route to a better next and the vision to take you further. This is the cloud experience everywhere. This is HPE.
Yeah, great Moody. It shows a lot of stuff. But the true question here is how true is this?
I think it's
so as a consumer, we see all kind of stuff coming up. We're saying, yeah, I need to give me 1 kilo, 2 kilo, one. So how true is this? Is this the way to go?
Yeah, definitely. I think this is based on the market dynamics that we have seen. So the demographic changes, the business changes, technology changes that we foresee. There will be a big, big shift towards the sharing economy and the subscription models. And for that, you indeed need all of the underlying infrastructure, applications, all coming together in order to make it happen. Yeah. So I can fully recognize the Moody that was just being showed. Yeah.
Right. Comment on that, Mel?
Oh yeah, fully. I was a nice Moody. I don't know, and the new word for me, Moody, but very recognizable. Yeah, a cloud is not a destination; it's an experience that helps you provide the experience for your clients in this new economy.
Right.
Yeah.
I do think one of the big challenges, though, is the amount of data that needs to be turned around very quickly, processed, turned around, and pushed back out to the consumer. And I think we're seeing more and more requirements and demands from our both consumer enterprises and our customers to be able to have that at the edge. And essentially, at the edge means in that multi-cloud environment. But back to the whole security agility piece, the volumes of data, to your point, as this grows, the volumes of data are just going to keep on getting bigger and bigger and bigger. And that kind of gets a bit mind-blowing after
right.
a while.
We will do a separate broadcast on the digital ads, also on the digital ecosystem, so to wrap that into. So let's look to the gains here, right, from a also leadership perspective. Are we ready for this? Right, from a leadership perspective, Mel? And I can ask you that as being a CEO.
I think we are, but we have to address one very important part, and that is the skilling of the complete organization. So this is not only about IT understanding the value. This is not only about the CEO understanding the value. It's every person in your organization needs to understand the value of the technology roadmaps we're bringing and how they can service our clients. So if we don't get that mastered, then we do not have the right skills. So this is a total reorganization revamp.
And then you're talking or referring to capabilities also in terms of digital literacy, right?
Yeah, so if we're looking, for instance, at new business models, we have to understand not only what our client wants, but what IT brings. If we are looking at data-driven decision-making, it's using that data to change models. So it's throughout the organization that we have to reskill our people. So yes, I think we are going there. I don't think that we understand the magnitude of the transformation.
But is that a fair point? In terms of magnitude, can you oversee this?
I think it's a full operating model transformation, what Mel is rightfully saying. So when I was still studying long, long ago, I always made these business model canvas views. And then you had all of the input, output, suppliers, buyers, consumers, economics of the model. All of those things will be changed and have to be changed in order to build those subscription models or deliver those subscription models, because they'll have impact or downstream or upstream with your partners. It will have impact on the way how your economics of your organization will work. It will have impacts on the balance sheet of the assets that you need to keep or don't have to keep on your balance. So it's a full operating model transformation and the magnitude is, I think, not to be underestimated. What is key in order to get there? It's, I think, understanding of all of those components throughout the organization. Let risk and compliance understand business and IT. Jump into the field of IT if you're a business person and the other way around. So really understanding what it will entail, and don't look at it from a siloed departmental perspective anymore, but truly see that digital means embedding and integrating all of those business functions to deliver value for your customers.
Yeah. How do you get that done, Mel?
A lot of talking, explaining, and collaborating. So I think it's starting with the collaboration. But I also see that when the going gets tough, it becomes a silo discussion, especially when it's on finance. And you always have to be able to step out of those silos, explain what we're doing, and then work together. And again, starting with the customer, the triggers that the customer has and faces, and then transforming it into solutions and not talking about capabilities alone.
Right. Yeah. What is the impact here for companies such as Equinix or HPE? In this discussion of leadership.
Yeah, right. So I think we need more transformational leadership rather than that kind of achieving day-to-day general management type of leadership. And I think the challenge there is that it's a different skill set. It's more of a strategic skill set. It's thinking about how your BAU is actually being so disrupted. It's not a simple problem to solve anymore. So it's not something that somebody from the top can go, oh, I know how to solve this. It's far more collaborative, mm-hmm. back to your points, and it's far more cross-functional. And I think, you know, Equinix itself is going through a whole transformation at the moment in terms of just our roadmap for becoming more of a digital partner rather than going from that data center world into digital services. So we're experiencing it ourselves. But it's a very interesting journey. And I think there's a lot more strategy required from leadership, which before used to be very a niche thing, whereas I think it's something that needs to be across the whole executive staff and further down.
And how does this reflect talents in a way? To gain talents in a different way from leadership perspective then?
Yeah, that's quite interesting. So I was reading a PwC report, which really was looking at where do you find strategists? And they're not in these traditional companies generally. They tend to be more in consultative type of organizations like BCG. And it's how do you get that into your organization? So I think, you know, just from where I'm sitting, I'm investing a lot in myself in terms of just coaches and really helping me to understand that I shouldn't be involved in operational problems. I should be involved in really challenging problems that involve lots of people. And if I find myself in one, I try and leave it alone and divert to where my skills are needed.
How do you handle that, Mel?
You mean the transformative leadership? It's actually also the diversity of your whole organization. Every single layer has to have people from different walks of life, different experiences. No group thinking on strategy. Yeah? It's really a diverse workforce throughout, and a lot of engaging. Strategy is not something from the top. Mm-hmm. Strategy is something understanding what's going on the work floor, asking them what the problems are, and then helping them solve them. It's not something from the top only, but the setting that direction is. Where we're going should be clear, but how we get there, you do together with your whole workforce. And I think for me, it's about putting the developer at the center. And I think from the whole organization, it's about putting the employee at the center. And listening to them, yeah.
Right. Yeah. So you had, Nick, as BCG, a couple of interesting remarks here there in a previous presentation where you said, okay, we are going to a flux of something like 70% on the current workforce. You can only 50% relocate them or by retraining them, etc. And then you get an influx of 30-40%, and then suddenly you have to grow. Massive numbers, apparently.
Yeah. No, talent management will really be turned upside down in the coming years. Yeah. I think I start my reasoning always with a World Economic Forum report that says that in 2030, 1 billion of the people need to be reskilled or retrained in order to be able to work in the digital age. This number is like mind-bubbling. It's it's super, super difficult. Then you have the trend of that a lot of organizations outsourced a lot of their IT to other companies, where you now see at least that some parts will be insourced again because they have more strategic capabilities and you believe that that part will have competitive edge over your customers. So there's also an insourcing, outsourcing dynamic and mix coming on. And then there is, how do I keep that talent to me? Because especially on the development side, we can work from our own desks nowadays, or after Corona. So I could also potentially work in the US or in Asia, where we see completely different compensation schemes for especially technical talent. So also that you have to deal with that dynamics. How do you build a cool and fun environmental place for your technology talent to act upon? So yeah, a lot of dynamics happening in talent retention.
And a lot of work of leadership going into exactly this person. Yeah. It's we're really in a people business.
Yeah.
Getting the right people in, training them, keeping them trained, always thinking about, and now also, by the way, geopolitical influences coming in, that you also really have to think where your people are based, how vulnerable you are, and then the security part again of your whole workforce. So it's mind-boggling and also a lot of fun.
So that reflects to the question, you know, what kind of steps do we still need to make here then? So in a traditional way, we've seen from the CEO perspective, right, and having their direct reports, and they were great in a matrix, right, infra and application security information, and then suddenly we need to have a holistic view, and suddenly we need to go agile, suddenly we need to go to the business, suddenly...
Yeah, but I think, again, on agile, so agile is not an IT way of working.
Right.
Agile is an organizational way of working. And what we need to be able to do, and much more now, and then that's stopping silos, when we see that we have a problem to solve, a trigger, a client expectance, whatever, we bring the right people from throughout the organization together, and not from IT, so it can be risk people, compliance people, customer experience, salespeople, put them in one team, have them work on that problem and ensure they get the right information and skills and knowledge to solve that problem. That's an agile organization. It's not an IT way of working. It's an organizational way of working, and I think it's the only way that we can be flexible enough to keep on transforming, because it's not a destination, it's a route of travel. We don't know where the destination will be.
Right. And if you then look to, and that was my discussion I want to make, is if you look to that CAO, CDO, CTO guild, so to speak, right? So what are the steps we really need to make?
I wish I... it's guilds of building, if you look at a CDO, CTO, CEO, CIO guild, if I look at from an organization, we have to build knowledge and expertise in our guild and then bring our people together to solve problems and collaborate on everything. It should not be guilds, actually. It's learning factories, bringing people in.
New way of also there.
Yeah.
So I should lose my subscription model on CAO.
Yeah.
All right, here we go. Here we go. What does it bring for you?
I think the thing to add is culture. So everything we do as a leader is that you put somewhere a milestone and then you say, okay, this is what the consumers of us expect. Let's drive together into there. But then what I said before is that if you are a new company, you try, fail fast, start again. So that culture, if you build a team like Mel said for a question of a customer or an issue, then that team should have the idea that they are more or less a company by itself. They can try whatever they want, they can fail, they can start over again. And then all those people develop the skills by themselves because they try, they develop, and they fail, they start over again. That's what you do. So the culture change, that is, I think, the key point over here.
Yeah.
Reflect on that, Nick?
I think it's true. I think it's an operating model change based on what we've been discussing, I think, around over the last 1 hour. And in order to make an operating model work, you need to have the right culture.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, culture, eat strategy for breakfast.
But how tangible can we make that culture?
So culture is very tangible. Culture sometimes feels like something very fluffy or something that you cannot touch, but you can make culture really tangible. It's about the habits, the shared values, the morale, the rules that you agree with each other. All that together builds up your culture. So culture can actively be managed in a way. It's not something that is just magically is there. It's something that you also need to work on in order to continually refine what are my values, what is my purpose, why I'm here sitting together. So no, that's definitely something that you need to work upon in an organization.
It's a muscle, eh? It's one of the muscles of the body, the managing body, and you have to start training it with simple behaviors.
Yeah.
And explaining what behavior you want to see in your organization, and incentivizing that.
Yeah. Right. Incentivizing norms and values. I think that's a bit what it is. Yeah.
And you have to stimulate that innovation by creating that safe place to fail, essentially. And that's, I think, something that traditional organizations haven't been doing as well as, you know, the digital kind of born in the digital age. And I think that's something that, from a culture perspective, you can have the culture, but moving to that safe, innovative, safe place to fail environment is quite a challenge.
And then to make them super tangible, I think if we say one of our norms is that you can fail fast and because you learn from it, then as a leader you can install certain failure forums, and then you can even give the failure of the month award.
Yeah.
I think there's even there's an institute, I think, in the allocated to the University of Maastricht. Mm-hmm. That's called the Forum of Brilliant Failures.
Oh, yeah.
One of the professors, I think he was ex-ABN, by the way.
Oh yeah, I think I know you.
Of the head of the Innovation Center.
Yeah.
And he actually now set up that forum, how you can incentivize failures in order to make a much more of a learning organization.
It's actually funny because we, within the company, we in the Netherlands, we try to see how we can lead the culture change, let's say. Yeah? So you try things like this. So we did the same. But actually, it's still pretty hard within us. We experienced people are still a little bit shamed, although we love that they failed on something. And then we would like them to share not what they did, but how they did it, just to show it. But yeah, people are still a little bit scared. So there's a lot of work for us to do as a leader to create still the environment that actually it's good if you fail sometimes.
Yeah.
It's the same with cycling. The first time, you flip over.
Yeah.
But if you never flip, you are not going to cycle.
You never cycle.
Will the change from an organizational point of view and an economy point of view, because also the whole society is changing rapidly?
I think so.
His perspective?
No, I think so. I think this is a societary change that we foresee that cannot be stopped, based on new generations, sustainability, circularity, different ways how we would like to live our lives. So it's a societary change, and I think business needs to follow.
Right.
We'll have to follow, yeah.
So that triangle of technology, society, and economy is getting more and more close and driving each other.
At least, indeed, reinforcing each other to make this change going even faster. Yeah.
Right. Interesting. So to wrap it up, I would ask each and everybody from you to have that golden nugget, right? Yeah, that's a fixed element in TV. So what is the number one do or don't do thing in the context of, let's see, the changes in subscription models, or at least let's see, there's changes in all kind of new models or cultural models. So what would be your golden bullet here, Judith?
I think all organizations need to be looking at their recurring revenue stream and figuring out how to turn it into a subscription model. And then it's really about having that agility around their whole digital infrastructure and digital transformation that they need to be able to scale up, scale down, provide what their customers need wherever they are in the world. That's essentially.
So you put an extra layer on digital first, it's subscription model first, right?
Well, yeah.
In a certain way. Well, thank you. Martin?
Make everything the customer asks to us as a company in a consumption-based model possible. And then, for me as a leader, I should create the environment, what I said, so the culture is that the company really tries to create the consumption. And if they fail, start over again. Because if you don't change, that's the thing.
Right. Good, serious one. Nick?
Maybe not a golden nugget, but a golden slide. I think if we now look at the page, then we see that everything can be shared. So everything can be shareable. I think some we already know, like are the cars, the houses, the rental storage. But we can go even one step further. You can rent out your Louis bag or your Hermes bag. You can rent out your dog, although personally my cats are not for rent yet. But I think if we position ourselves to take it a little bit more serious into the mindset of that everything can be shareable, we will enter a completely new era.
Pet for a day, egg for a day. Okay, that's cool. Kit for a day.
Already do that.
or then we get an ethical discussion again, right? Kit for a day. Yeah. All right. So serious last golden bullet, Mel, to your colleagues.
Yeah, I would say that digital transformation is not the IT roadmap. So it's not the data strategy or the cloud journey. That's not digital transformation. It's your whole organization understanding where the economy is going and how IT and technology is supporting it. And the most important thing you share in an organization is knowledge. So let's say that's the golden nugget.
Great. Knowledge, the golden nugget. Thank you. And if Mel says, you better believe her. And you know why. So that brings us to the end of this fine discussion. Thank you very much for this discussion. Do we have something else to say? Yes, of course, there's a second and third and fourth broadcast on this digital first strategy, how to build that, so to speak, in this digital leaders boardroom. But for now, stay safe, stay healthy.
Every connection, every link, every purchase, every update, download, trade, refresh, every yes, I'm still watching, and turn left here. Equinix is everywhere. As the world's digital infrastructure company, we connect places, partners, and possibilities. They all come together on Platform Equinix. Harnessed by the world's digital leaders, our global interconnected ecosystem is ready to power your success. With a physical and virtual infrastructure that adapts as your business transforms, you can unlock new opportunities and stay secure and connected across the most dynamic industries. You lead the way, we cut the lag. No buffer between start here and go anywhere. And with every leap forward, we look ahead to do better. In service to our communities, to our team, and to our customers. Together, we enable the innovations that enrich our work, life, and planet. Equinix.